you guys. It's just not right taking 2 weeks off. I tell myself that every single year, and it just happens that way. But I hope you guys had a good Christmas and a good New Year's, all that kind of stuff. I'm super excited because tonight the Capitol is turning 3 years old. Today's a birthday. So I know, right? It's such a good day. How many of you guys, I always like to do this, how many of you guys have been here since like pre-Capitol days? Let me see where you're at. There's a few of you guys. Okay. How many of you guys like maybe just started coming maybe this school year or newer? I always like to see kind of newer jumping in the crowd. Okay. And how about, so you're somewhere in between. I didn't get to raise my hand yet, but I'm just mad I want to raise my hand. Okay, so somewhere in between. Awesome. Still a lot of you guys here from day one. It's going to be good. I believe 2017 is going to be fantastic. Year three is going to be a good year. I guess our fourth year is going to be fantastic. I hope your year is better than Mariah Carey's New Year's Eve performance. Tell me you guys saw that. Like, I was at someone's house, and everyone's kind of just hanging out, and, it, like, people kept looking over, and, like, they're like, is this really happening? It was like watching a car accident. You just couldn't look away. It was so bad. You guys saw this, right? If you didn't, oh, my gosh. It was so bad. But 2017 is going to be good. Have you guys seen Wendy's killing it on the Twitter game? Have any of you guys seen this? This has been so great. So if you didn't know this, Wendy's went completely savage on Twitter, and someone tried to start beef with Wendy's, and they like retaliated. This dude named Thuggy G was like, why are you lying to everyone? Or I think Thuggy D, that was his name. And he was like, why are you lying to everyone? You know your patties ain't frozen. And then like, they got into this Twitter exchange to the point that it made Thuggy D delete his Twitter account. And then from then on, like, he's just been murdering people on I gotta check this out. You gotta see some of this stuff. They've been like, I've been like trying to update and catch up with them as fast as I can, and I just can't keep up. They're just killing people. It got so bad, one guy was like, please roast me. And Wendy's was like, I can't, why don't you get one of your 51 followers to do it for you? And I was like, dang. Just murdering people. What were some of the other ones? That was the same one. Wendy's did someone's homework. That was so bogus. They like took a screenshot of their geometry problem. They're like, fix all my problems. And they're like, okay. One person was like, hey, Wendy's, my friends want to go to McDonald's. What should I tell them? And he said, get new friends. And so it was like just murdering people. So if you're in for a good time, maybe just like try to roast. Get into some beef with Wendy's on Twitter and see what happens. Like, they've been replying to everybody. It's been so funny. And so I thought it'd be fun. Just, you're going to need your cell phone a few times tonight. If you've been with us for a while, you know, from time to time, we like to take some live polls, get your actual feedback. And so if you have a cell phone, you're going to need to send a text message to either the number 22333, or if you have a smartphone, maybe you got a new smartphone for Christmas, you can go to pollev.com/thecapitol. I think we're going to get it. We'll get it going in a second. They'll get it to you. It'll either be 22333, that's the phone number. You can do a text message, or you can do pollev.com/thecapitol. Okay, so there it is. So if you're texting, you gotta text the Capitol, all one word, to 22333, and then you'll just have some options. Or if you have a smartphone, it's a lot easier just to go to pollev.com/thecapitol. So I need to know if your favorite fast food burger place is McDonald's, you're gonna hit A. If it's Burger King, you're gonna hit B. If it's Wendy's, you're gonna hit C. And if it's Crystal that just opened up around the corner, you're gonna hit D. So if you're ready, here we go. Live polling is gonna start in just a second. Okay, let's see. Start voting. Let's see what we got. Okay. Wendy's has the lead. It's because you're afraid. You're like, this is somehow going to get back to Wendy, and she's going to roast me. McDonald's. Burger King's trying to make a climb. Crystal. It's a landslide. Is this for real, though? You guys actually prefer Wendy's over everything else? It's like a clear-cut choice. I will say, I pretty much lived off of Wendy's when I was in college. That 5 for 5 menu was killer. You could get the junior bacon cheese, and the chicken sandwich, and the chicken nuggets, and a Frosty and some fries for like $5. It was fantastic, so. Okay. It's so funny. You guys text all day, but then when it comes to polls, you guys, it goes so slow. A, B, C, or D. too funny. Okay. I'm killing it. You can keep sending it in. That was fun. Thank you guys. You're gonna need it two more times tonight. And so if you haven't already, your easiest bet's to go to pullhub.com/thecapital. Sorry, my microphone is being a little crazy tonight. But we're gonna have some fun tonight. It's resolution season. How many of you guys have made New Year's resolutions for the new year? And you're like, yes. Anyone like you've already jacked it up and you're like, I tried my best. I was like, maybe you were gonna take like a selfie a day and you forgot to. You wouldn't do that. You would never forget to take a selfie, would you? So let me tell you where we're going for tonight. And then we'll kind of backtrack and then we'll go there a million times tonight. Here's where we're going tonight. Here's something I learned a long time ago, a really good principle that I learned that's helped me throughout my years, and I believe it's going to help you guys tonight. And it's this principle. It's whatever you feed will lead. Whatever you feed will lead. Go ahead and say it with me. Whatever you feed will lead. So it's like this. Whatever you're feeding in your life, that's what's going to end up leading your life. Some of those things can be really good. Some of them can be really bad. But the principle is whatever you feed will lead. And so I want to help you guys make some good food choices tonight as we're in resolution season. And so if you have your phone, go ahead and bust them back out. Just open-ended question. You can reply whatever you want. Like I said, easiest way is to go to pullhub.com/thecapital. But if you want to go to text 22333, you can do that as well. But here's the question. What's your 2017 resolution? I'm curious on what your 2017 resolution is. Let me make sure I go there. Okay. It's live. So make sure, go ahead and go there if you can. I know that one's not going to be live. There should be a slide for it, though. So what's your 2017 resolution? Pullhub.com/thecapital. I'm just curious on what some of them is. They're going to start rolling in. Some of you guys are doing it. You guys need clarification. Yes, what's your clarification? Yes, sir. No, there's no options. Just tell me what your resolution is. You can type whatever you want. So someone put, like, be less bitter. These are anonymous, by the way. I would never, like, and I'm not dumb enough to let you guys put stuff live on the screens, so that's why it's not going on the screens. But actually put more effort into everything. Make it to my birthday. Give it all to God. That's cool. Thank you for being honest. Stop drinking. Be healthy. Be healthy. Be Betty. I think you meant be better. Forgot the R. Maybe like spell better. Is that your second resolution? Oh, acting like Wendy's. It's me. I run the Wendy's account. Give up soda. I see you will. Someone just put the capital. Thank you. Welcome. If we're your resolution, I'm honored. That's awesome. Stop talking smack about people. Work out 3 times a week. Get rid of laziness. Be on fire for God. Be nicer to... Oh, I'm not... That's God names. Be nice. Nothing. At least you're honest. I have no resolution. I am perfectly happy with who I am. That's awesome. Okay. I care about what people think. Chicken nugget. Cool. Be kinder to people. Open my own Etsy store. I do not have one. Period. Cool. I love it. Awesome. So you can keep sending them in throughout the night if you want to. Here's kind of my thing about the whole thing is that I think resolutions are good. Even when I don't usually like looking up definitions, but it's like that word gets thrown around so much. I was like, what is like the actual definition of resolution? And even within that, there was like 8 different, completely different uses for the word resolution. So they can't even like decide on how to use that word properly. It's an okay word, but I think a lot of times resolution is just like a general, I'd like to be some kind of better person this year, somehow, some way. And so I was kind of going through my 2017, setting some goals and resolutions and that kind of stuff. And then I realized I was going through some things that I've heard probably a gazillion times from like the business world. But maybe some of you guys haven't heard of this type of stuff. But I want to help you guys. Here's my thought for tonight. Again, along the lines of whatever you feed will lead. I want to help you guys decide what you're feeding into your life. And I think the best way to do that is that I think goals are a lot better than resolutions. I think goals are a lot better. Because resolutions, a lot of you guys put it, and it's cool, but they're very general. Like, I want to be a nicer person. I want to be a better person. A few guys put very specific, I want to work out 3 times a week. In the business world, they have these things called, there's all kinds of acronyms for them. There's like a BHAG, which stands for a bold, hairy, a big, hairy, audacious goal. It literally has the word hairy. I don't know why. Everyone uses hairy. Apparently goals have to be hairy. Or maybe your wig. A wig is the wildly important goal for a business. But whatever your goal is, I think that your goals should be smart. They have this thing called SMART goals. And so this is going to kind of help you pinpoint them. I don't have this on the slide, so if you want to take some notes, you can. But SMART, it's an acronym. Here's what it means. It means specific. In other words, not just this wild, I want to be a better person. I want to get in better shape. I want to be less bitter. A lot of the things you guys put, which is fine. They're all good things. But they're very broad. So in other words, you need to be a little bit more specific, like the person who put, I want to open up my own Etsy shop in 2017. I think that's awesome. Someone said, I want to work out 3 times a week. I think that's great. But you have to be specific. M is for measurable. In other words, we have to be able to measure it. And so you can't just say, I want to lose weight. How much weight do you want to lose? How many times do you want to work out a week? When do you want to open your Etsy shop? And so I think it's important to have it be measurable. A lot of the different letters, a lot of people have different ones, but the one I like the best is attainable, right? And so if your goal is to get to be in better shape, but you are morbidly obese and you couldn't walk down the street, and your goal is to climb Mount Everest, like it's just not attainable, right? And so maybe your goal is to start out with walking a mile, and then you go from there. You set goals that are actually attainable, and so then once you check them off, you can reach new goals. But make sure that they're actually attainable. Make sure that it's something that you're going to actually be able to do. So maybe you're like, man, I want to be a better person, and so your goal is to cure cancer. Well, that's fantastic. That's going to take a while. It might not be attainable in 2017. Maybe it is. Maybe you're that guy, and you're the genius we've all been waiting for. But, you know, or girl, my bad. Thank you. Make sure it's attainable. So that's A. The R word that I like the best is relevant. They use this a lot of times in the business world. What will happen is employees will be given goals for their year, and they'll come up with a goal, but it'll be to, like, eat less. But you're the director of sales. What does eating less have to do with being the director of sales? And so you got to make sure that whatever your goal is, it's relevant to your better life. So in other words, don't just pick a goal like, I'm going to burp 5 times a day, like that doesn't make any sense to your life. Like, think about the big picture of your life. Think about I want to be a better person. And make sure that your goals are relevant to the destination that you're trying to get to. Make sure it's in your future, on what type of person you want to be in the future. Make sure it's relevant to that. And T is time-bound, time-sensitive. Make sure, like, when is it due by? In other words, when is it due by? In other words, you should be able to come to me and be like, Pastor Matt, here's my goal, here's what I'm going to do, here's when I'm going to do it by, and here's what it's going to take to do that goal. So in other words, I like the person that said it, I want to work out 3 times a week. Great. It's time-sensitive. Or maybe it's a fitness goal. I want to be able to bench press 300 pounds by March, whatever it is. And so you've got your goals, and so you're able to measure it, attain it. And so here's what I want to do, because I believe, again, whatever you feed will lead. I want to help you guys, maybe give you some starter suggestion goals for year 2017. Because, being less bitter, that's great. It's better if you put the R in and all that kind of stuff. But I think I want to help you guys kind of get some goals that go along the lines of who we are and what we're all about. So we're starting a new series. We're going to be going over it the next couple weeks. It's just simply called We Are the Capital. We're going to kind of go over some of our core values, some of the things that are very near and dear to us. And so you're going to kind of see what's most important to us and how you can have SMART goals that are going to help you guys maybe jump along with us and be a part of what we're trying to accomplish as the Capital. So here's the first one. It's this: be better than average. And I'm going to make it more and more specific, but goal number one is be better than average. You're like, man, Pastor Matt knows how to set the bar high. We're going to shoot, reach for the stars. Like, I know you said attainable, but come on, like, be better than average. Here's average. The average church person, the average Christian, the average church attender attends church 2 times a month. That's the average, right? So some more, some less, but your average person that checks the box and says, yes, I go to church, I am a church goer, they go 2 times a month. And I don't know about you, but if you went to school 50% of the time, how would you do? Is that could be like, you're like, man, I'm doing pretty all right, you know? Or maybe like you just got a job and you show up to work 50% of the time. You're like, I'm here. Yesterday I wasn't, but here I am. You're welcome. Like 50%. In what other world is 50% doing an okay job? And yet here we are. Like that's the average. And so what happens is we get into this rut where like you can kind of give or take church. And I get it. There's a million other things that are super important. I get it. I understand. Some of you guys do sports and it takes you out for a few months at a time. So here's your goal. Be better than average. So and again, my challenge for you guys to make this your goal is to be here 3 or 4 times a month for the remainder of 2017. So what that means is if you get a job and you got to work some Wednesdays, you got to make up for it down the road. If you play sports and you're like, I won't be here January, February, but March I'm in, well, you got to make up for it. The goal is to be here 3 or 4 times a month. And for some of you guys, like you're like, that's great. But the goal is to take it up a notch, because here's what I observe. I get a lot of people that come up to me, how you been doing? Oh, not good. And your relationship with God is oftentimes directly correlated with how often you're here. Or I would say it like this, how often you're like mentally here, right? Like you might be in the room, this will be fun, but some people don't pay attention. They're like, they get on the phone and they go to the people on their left and right and they're like, yo, check this out. You see this, what's on the left or right? And then they're like, man, I'm not even paying attention. I'm getting roasted and I don't even realize I'm getting roasted because I'm on my phone. If you're gonna be here, be all the way here. Like, listen to what the person's saying, because it might just help you out. Okay, so if you're gonna be here, be all the way here, be plugged in, be engaged, be committed to be a person that's growing. My pastor used to say it like this: going to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than being in a garage makes you a car, right? So just because you're here doesn't mean you're doing yourself any good. You gotta be plugged in. You gotta be listening. You gotta be wanting to grow. You gotta be here with the intent of, I want to grow closer to God this year, and I'm going to do whatever it takes to get there. So that's my challenge to you guys. Hebrews 10, 24 and 25 says it like this. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. And let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. This has been going on since first century. Like, people think, I know God, now I don't need the church. I've got it all figured out, and now I don't need God. And here's what I hate. Here's one of my least favorite, can I tell you one of my least favorite parts about being a youth pastor? I promise not to tell anyone. This happens, I would say about once every month or so. I'll get an email or a phone call or a text from a mom or dad, and they'll say, Pastor Matt, I've done everything I could, but my son or daughter needs your help. Blah, 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 will you fix my child? Is usually the types of phone calls I get. And I'll ask them this simple question. Well, are they plugged into the Capitol? What's the Capitol? Great. This is going to be a fantastic start, right? Because we think somehow that we don't need the church to grow closer to God. But how often do you guys do on your own time of getting into the presence of God, worshiping with the body of believers, digging into God's word, growing, challenging each other, experiencing what biblical community looks like and doing life together? We need the church. And so I want to encourage you guys, be better than average. Be here 3 or 4 times a month. And if you could only come one time a month, guess what night I'm going to tell you to come on? Be here on small group night. You guys do not want to miss out on small group. How many of you guys love your small groups? I feel like we forgot that over the holidays for a second. They're like, are we allowed to cheer for a small group? Is that okay? I was just making sure. I got real scared for a second. I was like, man, everyone love being in a small group. So that's going to be the big deal. For real, if you can only be here from time to time, make sure you're here on small group nights. That's where we want you to be. So let me give you the other cultures that we're all about, that you're going to get when you come here. One of them is this is the family culture. We're all about small groups. The way we build family is small groups. I love when you guys come here and you guys are starting to treat each other like brother and sister, that you're starting to look up to some of your small group leaders as more of a mom, dad type role in your life. And we really do want to be all about family. For some of you guys, this is all you got. And I know that a place like this meant a whole lot to me when I was in your shoes, that I needed a place that it wasn't just a group or a cool place to hang out, but I needed some family. So we want to make sure that small group is family. That's how we accomplish a family culture. We don't just want to just set goals that are empty, useless, non-relevant. We want to establish cultures. And so family culture is definitely a big part of things. Second culture is an inviting culture. We strive to have an inviting culture that on any given week, you're welcome to bring guests, and they're not going to be weirded out. It's not going to be too religious. It's not going to be too unrelatable. We want to make it so that we can talk about what's really going on in life. And so if you came tonight, tonight's a great night to come, or maybe you came back for the first time in a long time. We're so glad to have you guys here, but we want to establish an inviting culture. The third culture that we're going to talk about this month is excellence and authenticity. If you've heard me talk about this before, I believe those are two things to balance. You can't have too much of one and not the other. I believe we need to balance excellence and authenticity as a church and as individuals. I believe that we should be the bestest, realest you that you can be. Don't be fake, but don't be so excellent that it's just not fake. And don't just keep it real, but be a sloppy real. Be the best you that you can be. And the last culture that we try to establish is our hunger culture. And our hunger culture just simply means we want to be real Christians. We want to be people that go after God. And so when I say I want you to be here more often than not, it's not because I just care about numbers, I care about attendance. I care about you. And it's going to be a lot harder for you to have a hunger for God if you're not in the house of God. Because remember, whatever you feed is going to lead. And so if you're feeding your job over your feeding your ability to be here, you're going to start pursuing money. The idea of to provide and to gain money and to have a job is going to start leading your life. If you allow that relationship and you're only feeding your boyfriend or girlfriend, you're only feeding that relationship, you're going to see your other relationships start to fade away. You're going to see your time here start to fade away. Whatever you feed, that's what's going to lead. And so my goal for you guys is to feed being here. Feed yourself on the things of God. And so here's where we get that hunger culture reference. It's in Matthew 5, verse 6. It says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they're the people that are going to be satisfied." There's people that are all over this world trying to satisfy themselves in all kinds of different ways. They feed on other things that they think will satisfy. They feed on romance, and they feed on drugs, and they feed on alcohol, but none of those things truly satisfy. I want you guys to hunger and thirst for the things of God. And so that's the first goal. Second goal is this. Join a team. Start serving. Serve somewhere. This is what I love. One of the things I love about you guys that I'm most proud of you guys for is that I see you guys all over the place on the weekends. I see you guys serving everywhere. I think a lot of times when we start talking about resolutions, we get really inward focused. We start talking about how we want to be a better person, we want to do this or stop doing that, and all that's great. But I say this a lot, is if you'll start taking your eyes off your own problems and start serving other people, God promises that He's going to take care of you. When you take care of the needs of others, God takes care of you. And so you need to get outside the bubble of church being all about you, and you need to serve somewhere else on the church. And so I love seeing you guys all over the church. You can serve in here on the weekends with Vic Kids. I know a lot of you guys serving here with Vic Kids. You guys can serve in the cafe and the bookstore. We need more people to learn how to run lights and cameras on the weekends and do some of those things. You're going to see us actually this weekend. We could really use your help. Johnson, this is so cool. Our pastor here at Hamilton Mill, Pastor Johnson, he said, we want the young people to be seen more and more and more. And so what we're starting to do this year, you've seen it a few times in the fall, but we're going to start doing once a month in 2017, is we're going to have basically a second greeter team that's going to be filled with you guys, with people that are in the Fusion, the 20-somethings age bracket, just to be a presence in the church. And so if you can give someone a high five and be a little extra energetic on a weekend, we'd love to have you. That happens to be this coming weekend. Pastor Johnson asked me to ask you if you would help me. So we'll send out a remind. If you're not getting the text reminds, you really should. You can actually reply to those. So we'll send out a remind. If you can help, all you have to do is reply back and say, "I'm in," and we'll get you connected from there. But we want to see you guys there. We want, if you have talents, if you sing or play an instrument, we want you guys to be involved with the worship team. We guys want you to use the areas that you're passionate about. Some of you guys, no, don't try that. Like, if you can't sing, don't do that. Don't do that. Serve where you're gifted. Here's the deal. We want you guys serving, and here's why. Because again, average people attend 50% of the time, right? Which we know is a horrible grade. 50% is a bad grade. I've had a few 50s. It never went well. The 50% test never got hung up on the refrigerator in my house, okay? So we know that's average, and that's not real good. And the average person who comes once or twice a month also doesn't serve. They are in no way connected to the lifeblood of the church. And so I believe it's for your best interest. If you can learn how to do the adult Christian life, if you can attend regularly, if you can serve others, you're going to be so much better off, because what the stats say about your generation are not good. They're saying that you guys are, the second you graduate, you leave the church and you never come back. And a big reason is because you're in a youth environment like this, and you have no understanding of what it's like to be in a quote-unquote adult church. And so that's why we don't spend a lot of time playing goofy games. We just preach the gospel, we go after God, we worship, and we teach you guys how to be young adults, because I believe that you guys are young adults. God sees you as an adult. He trusts you. You're mature. He values you as a young adult. And so you don't have to wait until you're in your mid-20s or your mid-30s to start being a part of the church. You're a part of the church now. And I don't know if you guys know this or not, but you guys are super blessed to be in a church like Victory that values you guys, that honors the younger generation. There's other churches. We just started Fusion, which is for our 20-somethings, a few months ago. And every single month, we've had at least one person come up to me and say, I'm here because I had a conversation with my pastor about starting something for young adults in my church, and they basically said it's not a priority. Either come to the regular service or go away. And so they've had nowhere else to go, and so they're finding a place here because this is a church that cares about the younger generation. So serve on a team. It's really easy to do. You can get out your phone even now or take a picture of the link I'm about to put up. But just go to victoryhm.com/serve. And we'll get you connected with there. There's different requirements for some of the different areas. But if you're interested in serving, we'd love to get you connected. We're not going to put you through like a different system for teenagers. Like this is the same link that's going to go out this weekend for the adults. Like just serve. Just get connected. Be responsible. And here's the deal. I put my neck out for you guys a few times. Can I have another honest pastor moment? I've gone out for you guys on a limb for you guys a few times, and we've done these kind of things before. And you've signed up to serve, and what's going to happen is a real life adult is going to call you because you said you wanted to serve. And so they're going to take you at your word when you say you want to serve, and they're going to call you, and they're going to say, great, when can we get you on the schedule? You have to be a real adult, you have to be trustworthy, you have to be mature, and you have to reply to the calls, reply to the emails, you have to show up for the trainings, you have to be responsible. Okay, so what happens if you apply for a job, get a job, then don't show up? Do you still have a job or no? Right, so you gotta do your job. You gotta be responsible. I trust you guys. Please, be if you're gonna sign up, be a man or woman of your word. Be a responsible adult. So, be better than average and serve. I think those are two good goals. So here's your goal. Join one team and be faithful in 2017. Some of them rotate through monthly, some of them are every other week, some of them are weekly, whatever it is. But join a team and be faithful for 2017. That's your goal. So attend more than average, join a team. Your third goal is this. I'm going to give you a goal to fast in January. I want to put it out there and put a challenge out to fast in January. I saw a lot of glazed looks and a lot of amens. It's a very divided room. So if you have no idea what that means, as a church, we do a 21 days of prayer and fasting every single year as a church. It's a fantastic thing. And so what I want to do is I want to kind of explain what that could look like for you in your life. Maybe you've fasted before, maybe you never have, maybe you thought you did, but you really didn't. So I want to kind of clarify what it means to fast. But we want to encourage you. So our 21 days of prayer and fasting, here's the challenges for you guys to join that 21 days in some way, shape, or form. It starts this Saturday, runs for 21 days, and then on the 22nd day, we're going to have a thirst service that's going to be next door. It's going to be on a Sunday night. You'll hear about it in the next couple weeks. It's going to be fantastic. It's so awesome. It's such a great time. So that's where we get hunger and thirst, because we want to be about the things of God. Because why? Because whatever you feed is going to lead. And so here's what fasting does. Fasting starves the other things that you've allowed to lead. It's the other things you've been feeding in your life that have gotten just out of place. Some of them are good and some of them are bad, but they've just gotten too far ahead of where they should be. And so what a fast does is says, no, I'm gonna stop doing these things, and I'm going to spend that time with God in prayer or worshiping God or singing songs to Him or reading the Bible. You're going to put away that to pursue God for that season for 21 days so that you're feeding the right things, because whatever you feed will lead. And so you're saying, I'm going to put a halt on this and give extra pursuit of God so that God can get out ahead where He deserves to be in my life. And so here's what that can look like. Here's the three main examples. I would say kind of level one would be like a no and then fill in the blank, right? Some of you guys do no social media. Some of you do no sugars, no caffeine, no coffee, no video games. Like you take like a thing that kind of means a lot to you and you just put that away for 21 days. And I already lost some of you guys. You're like, I can't do that. I just can't do that. And I want to say this. If you are in this generation, which we all are, you need to have a regular period of fasting social media, if I'm just being totally honest. It's good for you. Just like any healthy physical diet, it is good to have some diet from time to time, some fast to let some things aside. You need to have some time from time to time in your life. We have it often in our house. We just call it the no phone zone. You need to learn how to detox from technology. Again, it's not all bad, but when it gets too far ahead, if you don't know how to have a real interaction, if all you can do is look down, you just might be sitting next to the person, you can't talk to them, you're like, just text me instead. You need to put away some of those things, social media. You need to let some of those things just rest. Again, they're not in and of itself not bad, but I think everyone from time to time. So that would be like a level one. So some of you guys, I want to encourage you, like, put away the phone, put away social media, put away video games, put away caffeine, whatever it is for 21 days, and just see what happens in your life. But again, it's not just for the sake of suffering, and it's not just for the sake of a diet. It always cracks me up when people say they're gonna stop eating sugar or whatever, and then their only excitement is to see the results they had. They lost some weight or they had some more energy, whatever that is. That's not the point. It's to put away those things for the purpose of hungering and thirsting for the things of God. So pursuing Him, spending extra time listening to worship music or praying to God or reading the Bible, doing some of those things. So those would be kind of what I would call level one. What I would call level two, again, there's no clear levels, but what I would call level two is something that's called a Daniel fast. It's what probably those of us that do it in the church, that's probably the most common one that a lot of us do. And you can just look it up, Daniel fast. There's a guy named Daniel in the Bible. A few different times he fasted and kind of logged what he did and did not eat. But at its most simplest, most basic form, it is this: no meats, no sweets. So the Bible records that Daniel had the choice of eating meat. He chose not to eat meat. There's another time where he had what they call choice foods, and he chose not to eat the choice foods. And some people get way more specific than that, and that's great. But at its simplest form, it's no meats, no sweets. So basically the goodies, basically all the good stuff. Sorry to all you vegetarians, but that's already natural and easy anyway. But it's taking all the very delicious things that are easy to eat, that are easily accessible, and it's putting those aside for 21 days. And so that can be tough. That can be super tough for some. That can be like the most like habit-forming diet you've ever had in your life. Some of you have never thought about what you eat ever in your life. You just eat whatever your parents put in front of you or whatever you find in the pantry the fastest, and you just go to town and demolish it, right? Like, you've never even thought, like, is this a carbohydrate? Is this a starch? So I'm not going to get too technical. If you're advanced level, you can kind of look up some of that stuff. But again, it's just basically saying, you know, you basically do fruits, veggies, soups, things of that nature, things that are healthy for you, things that are good for you anyway. Again, the purpose isn't to lose weight, but it's simply to fast the things that you're used to eating, you know, no Wendy's for 21 days, right, all that kind of stuff. Maybe even no Chick-fil-A. It'd be like, it's like every day is Sunday at Chick-fil-A. You guys know what I'm talking about? Like, you're like, am I alone in that? Do you guys crave Chick-fil-A more on Sundays, like all the time? Like, you go to church, it's like, the two should go hand in hand. Like, I went to church, and I want to go to Chick-fil-A, but I can't, it's just the worst. All right, so that's the Daniel fast. Some people do, like, kind of intermediate level. Some people do fasts where, like, anything you can get through a straw, so there'll be lots of smoothies or soups or things of that nature, basically. So, prerequisite to any of these, though, obviously, if you have any kind of like diabetes or medical conditions where like diet really matters, for real, let me loud and clear, like, don't be stupid. Don't do things that your diet shouldn't allow you to. If you're concerned about that, talk to your parents, talk to your doctor, all that kind of stuff. But that would be kind of level two. Believe it or not, you can live without meats and sweets for 21 days. You will not die. But it'll be okay for a lot of you guys. So, unless you have a dietary need that's specific like that. Third level, which is very difficult, that's recorded in the Bible, is obviously no food of any kind. This is what Jesus did this from time to time. It's recorded in Luke chapter 4. It says, "Now Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan, was led by the Spirit into the wild. For 40 wilderness days and nights, he was tested by the devil. He ate nothing during those 40 days. And when the time was up, he was hungry. And the devil, playing on his hunger, gave him the first test. Since you're God's son, command the stone to turn into a loaf of bread." And Jesus answered by quoting Deuteronomy, "People do not live by bread alone." And so, in other words, he was saying, whatever I feed will lead, and I will not die from not eating that I believe that eating from the things of God is more important than eating itself. And so, again, if you choose to go that route, be very careful. You have to make sure you're hydrated. You have to make sure other things are well in place. That one is a little bit more dangerous. And so if you've read some verses that talk about, the Bible kind of talks about not making it super public when you're fasting. The Bible talks about what would happen in Bible days is people would fast and then they would act miserable. And they would go, woe is me, I'm fasting, I'm miserable, feel bad for me, aren't you impressed that I'm so holy because I'm fasting? And they would look miserable. But the Bible says, like, no, don't act like that. Like, act normal, wash your face, take care of yourself, take some pride in yourself, and just go about your life. Don't let people know that you're doing that. But if you're going to take on something more serious like that, let someone know. Let a small group leader know. Let a parent know. Like, let someone know. Let them be in on it. And I wouldn't suggest, if it's your first time doing that for an extended period of time. But I would say this. I would encourage you guys, skip a meal completely from time to time. Maybe you're going to say, I'm going to skip dinner on Wednesday nights, and I'm going to come a little bit early, and I'm going to spend some extra time praying. You will survive skipping a meal, I promise you. But you're taking that time and you're saying, I'm going to pursue God. I want to hunger and thirst for the things of God. And so I'm going to go after God in that way. But I want to encourage you guys, whether you've never fasted some, or maybe this is kind of an every year thing for you as well, challenge yourself. Don't just kind of go through the motions. Some of you guys, you might have grown up in this church, and this is just kind of what we do in Januarys, and you're just used to it, and you like talking to each other about what you're not doing, and all that kind of stuff. Man, challenge yourself. Give up something that costs you something. Make a sacrifice. Do something that actually does mean a lot to you. If social media isn't the big deal in your life, don't fast social media and then pat yourself on the back and think you're doing a good job. Give up something that's going to cost you something. Give up something that's going to make you want that thing or desire that thing, and it's something that you're going to crave. Because remember, these are the things that you're feeding in your life. These are the things that are leading in your life. And remember, whatever you feed will lead. And so you want to make sure that you're doing something that's going to cost you something. So here's what I'm going to do. If you have your cell phone, you can take them out one more time. And I want to ask you guys to just be honest with yourself when it comes to this hunger culture thing. Here's my goal for you guys. I want you guys to have a greater hunger for God in June than you do right now. So I'm going to check in from time to time throughout the year. And so, again, I can't track this. I won't know. But I'm going to ask you guys to be honest. Here's the third and last poll. Not that one, the third one. It's basically, where's your hunger at with God? Let me get there. Make sure it's active and ready to go. How would you rate your hunger for God? And so your options are going to be, you're like in a one or two, right? Maybe you're visiting us for the first time. Maybe it's been a while. Maybe this is like your January first Wednesday of the year. This is your way of getting right with God and coming back to church. That's awesome. But if you're honest with yourself, you're like, man, my hunger for God or my relationship with God is just not real good. It'd be like a one or two. Maybe it's a three or a four. You're like, it's not rock bottom, but it's definitely not good. So you're at a three or four. I don't do fives. If you know me very well, you know I don't do fives. Five's the cop-out answer. You're like, not good, not bad. It's like right in the middle. No fives. The option C is a six or seven. You're like, good, not great. It's not on the bad half of things. It's kind of on the good half of things. But it's on the low half of the good half. And so I'd be a six or seven. And then option D is going to be an eight or a nine. Oh, you guys can see it. Cool. So just be honest. No one's going to know. No one's going to see it. Just give your honest answer before the Lord. You're at an eight or nine. I don't do tens, because if you're ten, you're Jesus, you're perfect. You should be up here teaching us all, and we'll all follow you from here on out. But eight or nine, like, no shame about it. Like, you're on fire for God, and that's great. So just honestly, where you're at, cool. A lot of honest people in the room. I appreciate that. So it looks like about half of us are kind of, you know, good, which is pretty average if you go to church for a while. Like, isn't it just easy to get in a rut? You're like, it's good, but just kind of whatever. Like, there's definitely no passion, no hunger, no fire. And maybe that's where you're at. So, man, January is a great way. Fasting is a great way. Serving is a great way to kick yourself into gear. And so the goal should be you want to be in that next level. So even if you're in that eight or nine, maybe your goal for 2017 is to help someone else increase. Maybe that's off the scale. Maybe they're a zero. Maybe they have no faith in God. And so you're at an eight or nine. Your goal is to help others get to know God and then grow in their hunger for the Lord. And so wherever you're at, I appreciate the honesty. Thank you guys so much. You can keep sending them in. If you'd like to maybe do an amended What's Your 2017 resolution, you can send me those as well. Those are anonymous. We appreciate you doing that. So here's what we're going to do tonight. We're just going to give you a chance to kick off this year right. We're going to give you a chance to maybe you're in that one or two category. I'm going to let you bump up to a three or four right now. Actually, I'm going to let you bump up to a eight or nine right now, because here's what happens. God doesn't make you take prerequisites. He doesn't make you take, if you fail a test, he doesn't make you take the remedial courses before you take the regular courses. God's a good God, and his mercies are new every single day. And so you might beat yourself up, and you might think to yourself, man, I remember maybe a fall retreat, or maybe a retreat a year ago, or when I first started coming to the Capitol, I was on fire for God, and now you've given yourself a low mark, and you think you have to like make that slow, steady climb back up to God. You can jumpstart it, and his mercies are new every day. God says when you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you of all your sins. And so that's what we're going to do. We're going to open up the altars. I want to encourage you guys to come forward, sing, pray, do what you got to do. Don't worry about the people to the right or left. We want to make this a place where we can go after God, where we can establish a hunger culture in this place. And so once you do this, why don't you go ahead and stand to your feet. I do want to extend the greatest invitation on the planet to some of you. Maybe you're in this place, maybe you've fallen away from God, or maybe you're just checking things out. Maybe, like I said, I talked to you earlier, maybe you're in that 1-2 category, you're far from God, but you don't want to be. Like, this is a new year, new season, or you've never accepted Jesus into your life, or anywhere in between, but you just want to make that fresh start with God. If you would just bow your head, close your eyes, let's just be kind of between you and God. But I just want to know who I'm praying for. And so if you're just in this place and you'd simply say, man, you're honest before God, but you're like, I want to get back with God, or I want to start a relationship with God. If that's you, if you would just raise your hand real high so I can see it, so I can know who I'm praying for. Awesome. Yeah, no shame in that. We're all in this place where we're just trying to be real people who are growing closer to God. And so if that's just your way of saying, man, I just want to know God this year. I want to be an authentic Christian. This is where it starts. Again, be here. If you'll simply make the commitment to be here and give it everything you've got, you're going to grow closer to God this year. If you'll serve other people, you will grow closer to God this year. If you fast these 21 days in January, I promise you, you will grow closer to God. That's what he does. He promises his word. He draws close. Like the Bible says, those that hunger and thirst for righteousness will be satisfied. And so, for these next few moments, you make this place whatever you need it to be. If this is a place where you need to just sit and listen to God, if this is a place where you need to kick it into gear and you need to come forward and you need to worship, if this is a place where you just need to, maybe you need to pray with someone, whatever that is, but if you want to hang out and talk, that's totally cool. We just ask that you do it out in the lobby. There'll be no official dismissal, but let's just make this place a place of prayer, a place of worship, a place where we get to go after God and hunger for the things of God. So let's go.